Good morning, everyone. My name is Sidney Hankerson, and I have the distinct pleasure to moderate a very distinguished panel talking about how are we going to promote and implement youth mental health first aid. So briefly, I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself and then introduce our distinguished panelists this morning. I'm a psychiatrist at Columbia University Medical Center, and I conduct research focusing on reducing disparities in depression care. And the way that we're going about that is to actually implement mental health first aid into faith-based organizations. So we're partnering with pastors and with priests to try to reduce some of the stigma in our houses of worship. So now I'd like to introduce Ms. Suzanne Pearlman.
Hi, good morning. My name is Suzanne Pearlman, as Dr. Hankerson said. I come to you from New Mexico, Santa Fe, New Mexico. And my work primarily revolves around working in mental health and behavioral health, both in the adult and the youth system throughout the state for the last 10 and a half years.
Hi, I'm Janet Pozmantier. I'm from Houston, Texas. I work at Mental Health America of Greater Houston and our Center for School Behavioral Health, where we work to infuse behavioral health services throughout our school districts in the Greater Houston area.
Excellent. So first,
We're going to begin just to set the context for what youth mental health first aid is. Can I just ask, has anybody in the room ever taken a youth mental health first aid course before, or mental health first aid in general? Lots of hands. Okay, so this will be review, and there won't be a test later. So this is just the definition, that it's the help offered to someone who's experiencing a challenge or mental health disorder or crisis, and that you give that first aid until the crisis resolves. And support that person. And so basically, just like physical first aid or CPR, we learn what those signs and symptoms are and how we as lay people can stay in our lane, right? When we need to pass it off to a doctor, just like in physical first aid, or when we maybe are just having a conversation with someone, and the course really teaches you how to differentiate. And particularly with the youth curriculum, what we know is that 50% of mental illnesses, the signs and symptoms, will be there by the age of 14, and 75% by the age of 24. And so the opportunity for us as lay people to need to support someone with either the onset or symptoms of a crisis is pretty high. We know in any given year, 1 in 5 young people will have symptoms of a mental illness that are serious enough to warrant a diagnosis. And we know that in our lifetime, the prevalence is 1 in 2 of us will experience those signs and symptoms. And so it's important for us to know not only if someone is showing those signs and symptoms, but how to connect them with hope and help. So these are some of what the participants will learn. Like I said, the symptoms, the signs and symptoms, what those risk factors are, like where you live and possibly your genetics, etc. Information about that. A lot of our stigma around mental illness comes from just lack of information, and so oftentimes we really want to support someone, but we don't know how, and we don't want to make it worse, and so how do we learn more about how to support someone? And then there's the 5-step action plan, ALGI, for those of you who already are familiar. We'll go into that in just a second, but just like physical first aid or CPR, we learn how we might need to resuscitate someone if something was serious, or how we might need to put on a bandage if someone was injured. With mental health first aid, we really need to know, are we having a conversation, or what kind of supports might you need if it's a crisis? And then finally, what those supports are, both information, resources, as well as professional supports. And this is just a little bit more about what folks will learn. I think the most important thing is being able to tell the difference between typical adolescent development and the onset of a mental illness. Sometimes we're seeing those early warning signs, but you know, an early warning sign might mean sleeping a lot, and teenagers also can just sleep a lot. And so how do I tell the difference between if that's a warning sign or if it's just typical adolescent development? And this is our action plan, and so learning how to assess, are we assessing for a conversation, or are we assessing for a crisis, and knowing whether or not someone's in harm's way or having thoughts of suicide? how we listen non-judgmentally without judgment to maybe some really difficult things that someone might have to say, how we might reassure someone, and then encouraging appropriate professional help, what that looks like, and what a self-help look like given depression versus given symptoms of psychosis. Those are just gonna light up because they're super important. And then this is sort of moving on the continuum. How do we, you know, knowing that mental health problems are common, how do we increase our noticing skills? We know that stigma is common and often one of the barriers to folks reaching out for treatment. So how do we promote understanding? And then we know that professional help is not always on hand in New Mexico. We're the fifth largest state geographically, but we only have less than 2.2 million in the entire state. So where there's not resources and supports, how can I connect someone with something if I don't have a professional office close by? What about if folks are not seeking help? How can I promote a conversation that might remove the barriers to that individual getting the help that they need? And knowing that others are not well informed, how do I learn how to intervene, not only with the individual, but also if I'm hearing stigma out in the community, how can I have a real conversation about the truth when it comes to mental illness? One of the things that we talk about in the course are what are some of the things we hear when it comes to mental illness, and people often correlate violence. And what we know is that of the 100% of violence in communities across America, less than 4% are associated with those who have a mental health diagnosis. And so what we hear, what we see, is not actually what the truth is. So how do we promote the real information when it comes to mental illness? And then these are just some of the reasons why you might be a mental health first aider. We know that anyone can be a mental health first aider, including first ladies. We know Amy Kennedy, actually Patrick Kennedy's wife, yesterday just went through a version of the curriculum so that she can continue to be an advocate for mental health and behavioral health and have another tool in her toolbox, information about youth mental health first aid. And the most important thing of this slide is just that a couple years ago it got added to the National Registry of Evidence-Based Programs and Practices through SAMHSA, which is really powerful and says a lot about the curriculum, but also for those of us who are looking for funding sources to pay for things like this, because it's a part of the NREP, it makes it easier for us to include those in our applications to ask for funding and be able to get that as a part of this. And that's just a little bit more information about how you can get more information from the National Council.
Thank you, Suzanne, for that wonderful presentation. So now I'm going to open it up to questions for our panelists, and then we certainly want to hear from you to hear your questions that you may have for your respective communities. So Janet, the first question for you, how did you establish youth mental health first aid in your respective setting, and why did you decide to implement it?
Well, in Texas, we are the second largest state. And in Houston alone, we have almost 4 million people. So we kind of whoop you in New Mexico. I'm sorry, just in our one little city, our greater region. And in 2012, our local mental health association was approached by a number of school districts saying, we are becoming overwhelmed with the number of students that are exhibiting behavioral health issues, as well as the severity. We had longtime professionals in mental health in schools saying in their entire careers they'd never seen so many children and so many ill children as they were beginning to see in 2012. And so Mental Health America decided to do something about that, and they brought together a coalition of school districts and community organizations and government officials and interested parents and other advocates. And they decided to look at this issue in great depth to see if there was some type of systems change effort that they could lead. In 2013, they ended up publishing a report that listed 37 recommendations that could improve the prevention, the early identification, and treatment of behavioral health issues among students. And what I love about MHA is that they didn't just issue this report with a lot of fanfare and then go back to their office and go on to do something else where the report would just sit on the shelf and collect dust. They decided to do something about it and make sure that those recommendations became reality. So in 2013, we were in the midst of a legislative session, and seven of those recommendations were aimed at our state legislature. We were very, very fortunate that year that we were able to pass several items that related to school behavioral health. The most important one was Senate Bill 460 that mandated that all educators receive training in identifying the signs and symptoms of behavioral health issues among students and how to assist a student to get help. This was kind of unheard of in Texas. Usually it takes at least two or three times when when you want to get some type of legislation passed to get it through. And the legislature only meets every other year. I think probably we were successful in getting that legislation passed on the first try because unfortunately the tragedy of Columbine occurred in December of 2012, and there was a lot of unrest in the state about possible gun control legislation. And Texas is one of those states that does not like to have anybody mess with their guns. And so instead of having legislation that did anything about gun control, they decided to pass a few items that were very favorable for mental health. Unfortunately, even though they did put more money into mental health and they passed this law, we're still 48th in providing mental health services for our population. But we're a little better than we used to be. We used to be 49th, so I think we should be very proud of that. I can diss my state because I'm a native Houstonian and a native Texan, okay? So don't think that I'm some outsider who's talking bad about Texas. I can do that because that's me. So anyway, we had this wonderful law passed, and then this legislature actually even allocated about $5 million for the... to be able to bring youth mental health first aid throughout the state. Now, they were reimbursing at $100 per person trained, and I'm not really good at math, but in the greater Houston area, there's about 84,000 educators. And so our little allocation was not quite that big because they had to share that $5 million across the state. So our local mental health authority thought that they were doing a great job if they trained 400 educators out of those 84,000 every year. And about that time, we decided we needed to help them and do as much as we can. So that was one of the reasons that our initiative started to bring youth mental health first aid into the community as well.
So we have a little bit different of a story in New Mexico of bringing mental health first aid. We actually were a grantee of one of the Systems of Care grants. I don't know if folks are familiar. Grant through SAMHSA specifically for us to reduce the out-of-home placement and high level of services for young people who have a diagnosis of severe emotional disturbance. And so for those who aren't familiar with that diagnosis, really what it looks like is high utilizers of different systems, so possibly involved in the courts, probably have an IEP in school, maybe have a juvenile probation officer, different kinds of caseworkers, professional supports around psychiatry or counseling. And so the goal of that was really to try to keep these young people and their families together and in their community, and some of the values of that grant go hand in hand with, if folks are familiar with wraparound services, where youth and families should really be driving the decision makers of their own care, and that it should be culturally appropriate and respectful and humble when it comes to the way that we treat our families and support them. And so oftentimes systems can say that we know what's best, and families have been with their families longer and have probably been given many, many suggestions. And so really the focus is to humble down accordingly around letting families be the experts and professionals in their own lives and for us to support them. And then what we know through wraparound and systems of care work is that the outcomes are much more sustainable and impactful for that family. And so we got this grant, and part of it, if you've ever gotten a SAMHSA grant before, there's different things that you have to do because they say you have to do them. And one of those pieces was social marketing. And so that really had to do with increasing the education around increasing mental health literacy and decreasing stigma in order to drive people to services. And that was really awesome because we had a lot of folks who had a lot of misunderstanding around mental health. And so we chose mental health first aid as our anti-stigma and awareness campaign in order to begin to have a unifying language around mental illness. You know, when we grow up, we oftentimes, the first words we hear around mental illness are negative ones, or we whisper about it. And so we inadvertently teach people that it's not okay to talk about it and that it's negative, or we hear about it when we talk about the weather. We might use a diagnosis to talk about that. And so the irreverence that we had for it really needed to shift. And so we used mental health first aid as our anti-stigma and education campaign. And what we found, what was really amazing, was that it really could be used in different cultural communities as well, meaning as we partnered with the tribes and they were able to incorporate, you know, cultural teachings such as the four directions and language, working with different types of Latino and Hispanic populations and possibly their use of curanderos versus, you know, traditional Western methodologies. And so that was how we began to use it, and it really has helped us to begin to have a language that's common and respectful when we're talking about mental illness. And we've seen just really huge gains over the last few years. I think it's been probably about 3.5 years since the youth curriculum has been used in our state. And we began with people not knowing even what mental health first aid was. And so we'd spend that 15 minutes of trying to explain, what's this curriculum? And have you ever taken first aid? And now people are clamoring for it. And the demand is definitely beyond the capacity. And so that's a good problem to have.
Awesome. So I think we saw two different ways through legislation and through grant funding as a way to implement mental health first aid. So if each of you could share what was the major barrier that you experienced in trying to implement mental health first aid and how did you overcome it?
Well, there's several barriers actually. The first one I think I mentioned earlier, which was funding. There was simply not enough money to underwrite the costs. And so we work with every school district or organization to adjust our cost as much as possible. We ended up applying for several foundation grants so that we could cover our costs and delivering the program. So we've been very successful at that. We have also encountered barriers with the time that it takes to implement youth mental health first aid. We call it the Cadillac of all of the programs out there. Well, the Rolls Royce. I'm sorry. I don't want to, you know, the Rolls Royce seems to be the top car. It's the best thing out there, the best vehicle out there to train our educators and community youth workers in understanding signs and symptoms of mental health and issues and how to help everybody. But when it comes to school districts, it's really, really hard to get those 8 hours to train what we call the gatekeeper people, which is the teachers. They are very happy to train the counselors or the social workers or even the nurses, which is really nice, and we're happy to do it. But the counselors and the social workers couldn't be up there doing the training themselves a lot of times. They know the material, and who we really want to reach is the teacher, the one who can really pick up those signs and symptoms because they're in the classroom all day long with the students. So that's a very big barrier that we're working on constantly, being able to work with the school districts to help them understand how important it is that their people receive the 8-hour training. And we have to be flexible as much as possible.
So in New Mexico, our grant was housed in the Children, Youth, and Families Department. And so as an employee there, one thing that you should know is that in New Mexico, both our child welfare, so foster care and adoptions, as well as juvenile probation are all under the umbrella of CYFD. So incredible opportunity for us to be able to implement the curriculum. But the barrier is that oftentimes workers who've been in the field for a really long time feel like something's just the new flavor, and if I just wait long enough, it'll go away. I don't know if that's true for anybody else. And we oftentimes pathologize behaviors around mental illness, meaning the behavior is the problem versus the behavior is the opportunity to know that something is wrong with a young person. And there's some blame and shame that comes with that family for accessing the services, whether it's voluntary or involuntary. And so we really needed to move people on that spectrum of understanding at CYFD in order to see that this curriculum could help in the way that we engage youth and families. And so that was our barrier at first, was especially if you have folks who are in leadership positions making decisions on behalf of if your staff's going to be able to attend a training or not. And so some of the ways that we really moved around some of those barriers, and I'll just say it's not necessarily always putting a policy in place and saying, you're going to do this, right? Because have you ever trained a group of people who were forced to be in a classroom before? Not the friendliest group starting off, right? So for us, it was really sitting down and having a cup of coffee offsite and having a conversation about, you know, what are some of the barriers that you're running into? How can I support you? Here's how this curriculum might support you. We also have our reintegration and facilities where we have staff oftentimes who, you know, they're not making a ton of money, and in order to do training, they have to do it in such a way where not all the staff of a facility is out, so you had to stagger it, et cetera. And so it took us a while to get folks online and on board. And finally, I would say over the last year or so, we finally, our cabinet secretary and her executive team asked to take the training because she had been hearing so much about it. And the leaders really have been getting on board. And our big win, which we shared just this Sunday at the summit, is this fall, we actually, with continued work with our foster care and adoptions folks, became the first state in the country to have it as a requirement for all foster parents in the entire state of New Mexico to be required to go through youth mental health first aid, which is incredible. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I just wanted to add two things. There is proposed legislation right now in Texas, we're in the session again, to do the same thing. So hopefully awesome. We can be number two. And another barrier that we have experienced is that people just don't know that this law exists in Texas. For example, a year ago, 3 years after the law was passed, I was at the Texas School Social Worker Conference or School Counselor Conference. I had 100 people in the room, and I said, how many of you have heard of Senate Bill 460? And I explained it. Raise your hand. I had two people out of 100 counselors, social workers, school-based people who did know about this law. The other 98 people had no idea that this law existed. So there's been a lack of pushing this out to our school districts and helping them know that this is mandated. And I think part of that is because there's no reporting requirement on part of the schools to be able to report back to the state that they have, yes, we have trained our people, and you know, here are the names of the people and the date that they were trained. So right now, today, in Austin, our staff is testifying for legislation to mandate that the schools must report that they are training their people in this, so we can put a little bit more teeth into the law.
Awesome. Well, we'll hope that session goes well. So lastly, before we open it up to the audience, is what is the one thing, the one most important thing that you would like the audience to know about youth mental health first aid?
You go first.
So I think when it comes to New Mexico, oftentimes when we think about curriculums and an 8-hour curriculum in this case, that sometimes even just going through a training that you might not be able to move people along a spectrum or move people along their understanding. And the one thing that I would want you all to know that youth mental health first aid has saved lives. It's changed minds, opened hearts, and gotten people to take action in their own spaces. We have seen executive directors who've gone through the training and then make it a requirement for all their staff at a provider agency. We've seen folks really believe in the power that the front people who are sitting behind a counter will have the little glass door open if they feel more comfortable and confident with what it is that they're seeing coming into the waiting room of a probation or a child welfare office. And it seems like such a simple thing to just give people a little bit of information about what mental health might look like, but it really, just this 8-hour course has the potential to save lives in your communities as well. And that's the one thing that I'd really want you to know.
I would definitely agree with that. That's been our experience as well. And I think one of the other important things is that it has done a tremendous amount of good in eradicating stigma in our community as well. We do a lot of work at the beginning and throughout the course looking at why people stigmatize other people who have mental health issues, why parents may not want to let the teacher know that their child has a mental health issue, or if the teacher gently approaches the parent and says, I'm seeing this, I'm noticing this, and I'm wondering if you might want to, you know, take your child, whatever, and why a parent might say, there isn't anything wrong with my child. You must be a bad teacher if my child is behaving that way in your class, because at home my child is not like that. You know, why a parent might be resistant to hearing this type of information about their child, because one of the things we do at the beginning of the Youth Mental Health First Aid class is we do an activity where everybody has to think of typical terms that people use when describing somebody who has a mental health problem. And you can imagine the list. It starts with crazy, and it doesn't get any better, you know, and it's a big old list. And then we ask them to brainstorm positive ways that you could describe a person who has a mental health issue or condition. And it takes them a lot longer, and it's a much shorter list. And then we hold up the big and the, you know, the two lists and say, which one was easier to do? And they say, of course, the one that's negative. And then we go through and walk them through and help them understand that if this is how society, because this reflects society, typically looks at mental health, people who have mental health issues, why would anybody, A, want to tell anybody if they were having problems, or B, if I was a parent, why would I want anybody to know that this was happening to my child? And so we take it from there, and then we walk through the rest of the class and helping people to understand how they can gently approach this and how they can understand this. And so we really feel that when they come out of the class, they write all over their evaluations how it's opened their minds, how it's changed their attitude towards people who have or children, students who have mental health issues, and how you hear the word coming out all the time, I have more empathy for what the students are going through, more compassion for what the students are going through. We've also incorporated a little bit about trauma-informed classrooms in our youth mental health first aid training. And so we help our educators to understand, really just look at every child as coming from a trauma background, because you don't know. Many of them do. Two-thirds of them by the age of 18 have experienced at least one or more traumatic experiences. And so how you react to a child can make the biggest difference in how responsive that child is going to be, how well they're going to do in your class, and how well they're going to be as far as their mental health through the rest of their life, and how the impact that an educator, that one person can have. Mm-hmm. There's a video in Youth Mental Health First Aid with Kevin Hines. He is a suicide survivor. He is incredibly powerful. It's one of the most important parts of the Youth Mental Health First Aid course, and how it impresses upon everybody who goes through the course that it just takes one person to notice and to say one thing to somebody that can save a life. Mm-hmm. It's extremely empowering for everybody, and we've had incredible experiences with it.
So now we'd like to take questions from the audience. Ruth?
Hi.
Wait, 1 minute.
Thank you so much. It sounds like amazing programs. We're trying to do some of this in New Jersey. I just wondered, since you have a SAMHSA grant and you have an appropriation, what you use as a mean to evaluate your effectiveness. We're waiting for national data, and we find in marketing it's nice to have that. Do you have anything for your grant or for your appropriation on that?
Yeah, so we've been using, the curriculum itself comes with an opinions quiz at the beginning. And so as a part of that activity, it asks a series of questions about what you think about some of these items. And so as a part of evaluation, and there's also an evaluation of the course at the end as well. And so we use the opinions quiz as a pre and post in order to look at the shift of understanding, which oftentimes, if this is the first time somebody's having a conversation about mental illness, you really see a big shift on that opinions quiz, and then the evaluation tool itself.
Anything long-term?
We haven't. We know that the National Council's been partnering with Georgetown around the longitudinal surveys, 3 months, 6 months, but locally in our community we haven't. And one of the things, actually, I'm going to be talking with the National Council later today, is talking about how we might do a little bit more in partnership with Georgetown so that that's consistent with the way that they're looking at the data nationally so that we can go along with that in New Mexico. Thank you.
And the gentleman here?
Gentlemen, thank you. Are you doing anything? Any training? Any training with law enforcement, for example, school resource officers, because oftentimes they know the family and the kids outside of school in the community or at home, and they're called out for behavioral issues?
Well, in Texas, we also got a law passed in 2015 that all of our school resource officers have to be trained in a variety of things, including child development and child psychology and children's mental health problems and things like that. And so there is a special training that was developed for that population. It's actually a 3-day training, and elements of youth mental health first aid have been incorporated into it. Yeah.
So really quick, in New Mexico, with the youth curriculum, there's an AWARE grant. So if you all are interested in getting grants specifically to pay for mental health first aid, you can look on SAMHSA.gov, their grant site, and look up the AWARE grant. So we have two. One, on the youth curriculum, Albuquerque Public Schools has been implementing the training in the curriculum down there. And actually, I was a part of a big day where we trained 300 school resource officers all on one day throughout the district and throughout the county, which was phenomenal. If you wanted to see a room where we went from just talking about behavior, so if we think of a young person as like an iceberg, and the behaviors are what's out of the water, and the psychological distress, it's what's not being addressed under the water, we really began to move beyond what was on the surface with that group on that day. And then with the adult curriculum, we actually, I was the project director of a grant that we specifically have been partnering with Albuquerque Police Department, New Mexico State Police, our reintegration and facility officers, as well as fire, EMS, et cetera, in both Bernalillo and Santa Fe counties. And the biggest success has been New Mexico State Police actually, through the work with the grant, identified a position specifically to be responsible for implementing crisis intervention training and mental health first aid as a partnership curriculum throughout the entire state with all New Mexico State Police officers. And they actually just now were shifting to them, they want to be, and there's already four of them who have been trained in the youth curriculum, and they're using it as an outreach strategy to develop relationships within communities and provide the training at no cost to the community members in order for them to build relationships and partnerships.
And before the next question, I think this brings up a great point about special populations. There are special segments for veterans, for police, as well as for older adults. So if you have a large population of any of those special populations, there are specific training modules in mental health first aid for those populations.
And that's with the adult curriculum.
Yeah.
So
right.
So if you all are looking into those, really great modules.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, I have one quick question and then also adding on to wanting to know about training your security officers at school. So what about, if you do any training around the other staff, like the coaches that are engaging with the students as well? Did that happen there?
Also in 2015, the original Senate Bill 460 that was just for educators to be trained was expanded to include any other school personnel, the people in the front office, the bus drivers, the coaches. So all of those people now are entitled to the youth mental health first aid training.
So the other part of that is I'm curious about involving youth. We are talking about our youth peers in the workforce and engaging. Have you been doing any work around doing the first aid training for youth as well in your any of your states?
So what we found in working with youth in New Mexico is that oftentimes, and we really focus on the transition age youth, and the youth curriculum itself is actually intended for adults who work with youth ages 12 to 18. And what we've found is with our transition age youth that actually the adult curriculum works a little bit better. Usually at this point, transition age, 16 and older. And first of all, there would need to be some sort of permission form or what have you, which is what we've done in making sure that the maturity level matches being able to go through the curriculum. But in the courses where we've taught it specifically, so we have Youth Move chapters. Are folks familiar with Youth Move? So these are young people with lived experience who are empowered and advocates in the community. And so they were very interested in getting some of the youth engaged and trained. And so we use the adult curriculum with them. Oftentimes their experiences and level for being able to use that much more matched the adult curriculum. And really focusing on using the youth curriculum itself with those adults who are working with that population, or for them to be much more aware of what they might be experiencing. I don't know if that answers your question. Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Or is there a modified curriculum that encompasses both
of us? You know, at least for us, I just feel so strongly that you really understand the spectrum of ages by being able to go through both curriculum. Each of them are 8-hour curriculums, and they really, as I said, the youth focuses on that typical adolescent development and the onset and really focusing on what that looks like. And the adult curriculum really gets into a little bit more of understanding each of those diagnoses a little bit more in depth, and how you might interact with somebody who's an adult, right, who's making different decisions for themselves than you would if you were in a relationship with a young person. As an instructor of both of the curriculums, it lends itself well for me to be able to talk about all of the age ranges a little bit better by having experienced both curriculums. That would be my recommendation. How about you?
Yeah, I would agree. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Have you had any experience with foster parents?
So, and I probably said it before you came in the room, but we were saying in New Mexico, it's a requirement by September of this year for every foster parent in New Mexico to go through the curriculum. So,
And there's proposed legislation right now in Texas for the same thing to happen. So, thank you.
Gentlemen here, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Russ Duke, and I'm a public health director, local public health department in the state of Idaho, and we are just now introducing mental health first aid to some of our rural schools to teach school staff. And it's a little bit, I guess, connected to this is what I understand the Band-Aid and stop the bleeding, but one of the challenges we have is there are no behavioral health providers in these communities, and I'm certain that New Mexico and the state of Texas has the same challenges. What advice do you have as we're teaching staff about the importance of identification and asking, and then what do we do next? How do we connect them to resources? And I say they don't exist because they don't, but there's telehealth or telemental health, there's other things. I just wondered how you all may have addressed that in your states.
So in New Mexico, we right on the same wavelength. And so one of the important things that we did was we advocated for and got a 24-hour crisis line with not just people trained to be on the line, but actually clinicians on the other end of the line in every language that's spoken in our state. As a part of that, that partnership was with Protocol out of Oregon. And as a part of that, we also did a really in-depth sort of assessment of what did exist in communities. And I think what we found is a lot of times we talk about, I'm not saying that it's not true for your state, but a lot of folks go to that a lot of times, that there's nothing in my community, we don't have anything. And when we start to dig in, we find, the churches are actually hosting really great AA programs, or there's really cool peers in recovery that are working in that community. Or there's, sports programs or things that are a part of the fabric of that community. And so oftentimes our mind goes specifically to maybe some of those gaps around psychiatrists or psychologists, but there are some really great supports that are on that spectrum. And so what we did was really work to identify where those were, make sure that crisis line, which is statewide, was aware of those so that we could do warm handoffs, and then really make sure that as we're doing the curriculum, that we always have an information table in the room that includes that resource information for specifically that community, because oftentimes that's the first thing that we go to, but we don't have anything here. And a lot of where that comes from is the fact that we so little talk about mental illness that we just don't even know what some of the resources are in our community. And just to add to that, one of the things that we train in the curriculum as well is, if you're not comfortable, you just went through an 8-hour training and maybe this is the first time that you're talking about mental illness, that maybe you're engaging with someone and you're not necessarily comfortable to go further down the road of, are you having thoughts of suicide? Using those resource lines and being able to connect with a professional if the conversation gets to a place where you feel like it's above your pay grade.
Yes, yes.
So I have three questions. Okay?
I'm sorry, Sidney. Could you try to just do one? Because we want to try to get to everyone.
Okay. Well, I guess my question was for you.
Okay.
About engaging the pastoral community.
Yeah.
Because I think they're a really important population to spread the training. And we've thought about ways that we might get all of the pastors to do sermons on the topic of mental health, just to promote youth mental health first aid in our community. What strategies have you used in engaging the pastoral community?
That's a great question. So I currently have a grant from the National Institutes of Health to implement mental health first aid throughout a coalition of over 90 churches in Harlem. And we're currently working with two churches, but we're certainly going to disseminate it to a broader audience. And some of the strategies that we've used are having workshops on mental health problems. And instead of calling the workshops talking about depression or suicide, we say, come figure out how we can all deal with stress. Because that's less threatening, especially in houses of worship. People may be put off by words like depression, suicide, and substance use. So using non-stigmatizing language has been an important way that we've engaged pastors. I think another way is really to have a champion inside each organization. It's crucial to have either a leader of a health ministry, or if you're in schools, a principal, or if you're in foster care, the leader of the agency, to be supportive of youth mental health first aid, because they can be the advocate within the organization who is going to help you disseminate it. And then I think the last thing that we've done, we are actually New York City in the month of May, in honor of a National Mental Health Awareness Month. Every pastor in New York City, we've sent out invitations for them to speak about mental health on the third Sunday of May. And so we've kind of given some statistics for pastors to use, such as major depression is the number one cause of disability in the world, so that pastors can incorporate those types of messages into their sermons, so that people can be aware of the prevalence of mental health problems. So those are some of the ways that we've addressed kind of houses of worship. Sure. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Lauren Lewick, from the New Jersey Mental Health First Aid Program. I've learned a lot about both of your state's initiatives. It's been very helpful. And Suzanne, you in particular spent some time on the phone with me a couple of years ago, and I'm talking, I'd like to ask a little bit more about creating capacity among the instructor corps.
Yeah.
And one of the things you told me made a huge impression, you were talking about your tribal communities and how important it was to create leadership from within. And I think that's something that we want to talk about, because creating diversity among the instructor corps, I think, is very, very important. And I'd love to hear you all comment a little bit more on how you address that.
Thank you for that. And so, for those who didn't hear, the question just had to do with developing capacity within the communities that you're trying to serve. And so, in New Mexico, we actually have 23 tribes, nations, and pueblos, and make up about 11% of our population. And although that's a small percentage of the population, it actually, we know with disparate populations that the percentages when it comes to both health and mental health issues can be much higher. And so for us, one of the things that we learned really early on is that, you know, my circle of influence is going to be different than everybody else's circle of influence, and that I'm not going to be able to speak just as Dr. Hankerson was talking about with ministers, if that's not my background, if I'm training to police officers and that's not my background, when they ask me about some of the things that really go on within that community or that culture, then I'm not really able to answer in a really genuine and authentic way. I might be able to sort of project what my thoughts might be, but that probably would come off as being really disingenuous. And so what we did really early on with our grant funds, and I'm glad you asked that question, was we actually made sure that a component of that was developing capacity of instructors. And so it costs about $36,000 to have a train the trainer come to your community, but then you can have up to 30 instructors trained. And then as long as they train 3 per year, that's it on cost, besides, you know, paying for the curriculum and what, you know, the manuals and everything. And so we really focused on making sure that for the populations that really have these high percentages of SED or severe emotional disturbance, that we were making sure that we had instructors as well who spoke the language, who lived in those communities, who had the same experiences, so that they could then have the influence of really training in the community itself. And so it was really just making sure that there's seats at the table for those who are working with. And I think all of us have heard that nothing about us without us sort of anthology, like that we should have our youth at the table if we're talking about youth, and our families at the table if we're talking about families, and that they're the ones who are really informing us about how these things are impacting them, or even being the ones who are making the decisions about what we're bringing to the communities. And on that note, that was one of the things that we did really early on, was making sure that folks agreed that mental health first aid was the direction for us to go. And once we had that buy-in, then folks really wanted to have their own instructors. And so I'll just lastly say that of our 23 tribes, 13 of them have their own instructors in the community training with their language, which is, you know, much more impactful with sustainability. Thank you.
The cost of it. So, you know, there's manual cost, but so if we're not getting grants, what is the cost? What's the schematic for training the trainer? Who, what level of education the trainer has to be? So, it's a great product. So how do you get it if you don't work and everybody gets grants?
Yeah, it's a great question. So it costs about anywhere from $1,600 to $2,000 to go through. If you're an individual and you want to go and just take the train the trainer course out somewhere else. So in our community, we offset the cost through the grants. And so the cost per person ends up being about $1,600 for us. If you were to go to a national training, I believe, and I know there's national people in the room, it's about $2,000 to go through the train the trainer course. And that, of course, doesn't include if it's in another city and you've got to go there. When it comes to training the course itself, every person who goes through the course has to have that manual. And let me just say, the Youth Mental Health First Aid Manual is phenomenal, chock full of wonderful resources for all of the disorders that are discussed and where to go and how you get help. Those cost approximately $16.95, I believe, per manual. And so sometimes communities will pass that cost off to participants. And so a participant might pay $25 to come, and then I get my manual, I get a cup of coffee, maybe a protein bar, and then I watch, you know, and oftentimes we offer up to 8 CEUs as a part of the course as well, which I'll tell you, that's a big driver, especially those folks who need CEUs. And so sometimes that can be a barrier, which is why we really went down the road of grants, so that we could embed the sustainability. But you know, you make a good point that there's definitely, if I'm not paying for it, somebody's paying for it, right? Because there is a cost associated.
Do grants go out to private organizations?
What do you mean?
Like a nonprofit?
That's,
yes.
Yeah. You know, not a nonprofit. There's some treatment agencies in the country that are private, for profit.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure. I know for sure that tribes and, you know, FQHCs and healthcare organizations, et cetera, can apply. I'm not sure about the limitations around for-profit. That would be something to ask SAMHSA.
Janet, did you want to?
Oh, I was just going to add that when we contract, you know, we have 5 people right now on our staff that are trained facilitators. But before that time, it was just me. And so I always like to have a co-facilitator. And so I would contract with somebody else in our community who was a trained facilitator. And so I had to add in the cost of contracting with that person. We paid them $300 a day. It's really an 11-hour day in the greater Houston area, because even though the training itself is 8 hours, it might take you an hour to get to the location. You want to get there at least a half an hour early to set up. You want to be there at least a half an hour later if people want to come talk to you, and then you got to drive, you know, back home in the traffic. So, you know, it's an 11-hour day. $300 is really not that much, but we have very generous people who will agree to that as their consultant fee to help us co-facilitate.
And just a final word on grants. For people who may be interested in writing grants, the National Council has put together an amazing toolkit of how you can write a grant based for your organization. They have statistics on the prevalence of common mental health disorders that you can just basically insert into your grant. So I definitely encourage you to visit that website. Yes. Well, I'll say two things to that. First of all, I'm so sorry to hear about the tragedy in your community. And I think that there has certainly been a rise in suicides in men of color in particular, and in adolescent Latina females. So this is a huge issue facing our communities. I think that the way to hitch it, again, I think to reach as many people is to embed mental health problems within the context of dealing with stress or dealing with family issues or dealing with money issues, because those are things that are likely to trigger suicide. If you have financial distress, criminal issues, or family issues, I think that can be a non-threatening way to engage people to come, and if you embed information about depression or suicide within that, that can attract people. Another way, just a shameless plug, I'm actually giving a TED-like talk in a few minutes about mental health in men. So feel free to come to hear a little bit more and see a PowerPoint presentation about that.
And if I could just add that for any instructor in the country has access to the slides that you just saw and can pull some of those marketing. So sometimes the first conversation isn't going to be the training. Somebody needs to hear a little bit more about the training before they buy in. And so all the instructors have access to be able to pull some marketing slides down and help with that kind of presentation.
And I'd like to add, again, my condolences to your community. My personal faith-based community went through a similar experience this past year. We lost 9 young adults within a 16-month period to suicide. And the leader of one of our community organizations in that faith-based community said, this has to stop. And so she reached out to me and other people, and then we started to have community forums. We got many people who attended. I got about 50 people who signed up to go through the both adult and youth mental health first aid trainings from that. And so we are working very closely with that community to get as many people trained in both adult and youth mental health first aid. There's a lot of momentum. They even hired a person on staff who's going to be dealing with the young adult population in particular. And 8 out of 9 of them were young men, and one of them was a female.
So, yeah. Saw a hand over here. Yeah.
I have one quick question. So I applaud you for the mandates from your states, but has there been any talk in terms of attaching state funding to help, you know, kind of embed trainers in those school systems and in the foster care system?
So when it comes to actually having an appropriation, New Mexico is not there yet. And I'll say that's why we've been trying really hard to embed sustainability around getting the instructors, because then that can sustain it beyond the grant funds. But I know Texas has had some success around that.
Yes, our legislature appropriated $5 million over the biennium for youth mental health first aid training. That's like $2.5 million per year. The sad part about that is that it was appropriated to our local mental health authorities, which is, you know, government agencies, and they were very slow on the uptake. They didn't get their facilitators trained. They're not pushing it out as they should in the community. They did in the greater Houston area, which I'm very proud of, but not in some of the other communities. So I've seen the reports. They have to make a report every 2 years, how many people have been trained, how much money was spent and all that. And the first 4 years, they did not use all of the $5 million, which could have been gone just in the greater Houston area to get half of our people trained. And so, but it's for the state. So there's some issues with that. We're hoping in this biennium our state has a shortfall. As I mentioned before, we are right in the middle of a legislative session. We have a lot of dedicated people in our House of Representatives to mental health. I'm hoping they will not cut that money if they happen to look at it and see that it wasn't all spent in the first few years. But I'm very hopeful that they will not cut it, and hopefully they might even give a little increase. And
we did have one county who added a tax, and they're using that tax, mental health tax, to pay in Bernalillo County, where Albuquerque is, to pay for a spectrum of mental health interventions, including mental health first aid. So that's another option around funding.
I think we have, thank you, Betsy. And if any of you all have questions about the National Council on Mental Health First Aid, Betsy is the person to talk to. All right, I think we have time for one more question. Yes.
That's a great question. When we train, usually teachers or other community-based organization, youth workers, we have trained people who work with special populations. In fact, we have one trained, we have one scheduled coming up in and this is not necessarily dual diagnosis, but for people who are refugees and they suffer tremendous trauma, and also for people on the autism spectrum. As far as other diagnoses, we're not necessarily aware of who we're training at this time. We haven't received calls from those organizations, but we certainly reach out to all youth-serving organizations in our community, and I would not be surprised if in the future we would be doing more of those trainings. So we work also with our local Council on Recovery, with those who are dually diagnosed with substance abuse disorders, and we did train all of their workers, all of their professionals in the youth mental health first aid training.
Okay, I'll keep an eye out for those trainings.
Thank you.
I just wanted to add that this summer I'll be working on a project with Indian Health Service, and who we're training specifically are the community health representatives, specifically around individuals who have a diagnosis of diabetes. And so how do you, when you go into someone's home, specifically to be there to focus on health, we know one of the greatest risk factors for a mental illness is having chronic illness or other mental illness. And so how do we begin to see the warning signs, and we know that just about 70% of people who have a mental illness will only report the physical symptoms and not the emotional symptoms, so sometimes that can get missed. So how do we train health representatives, health workers, to begin to notice and ask those questions?
So thank you all. In closing, I'd just like to thank our panelists, and thank you all for coming to today's session. And I just want to emphasize a point that was made today by our panelists, is that mental health first aid saves lives. And if there's a way that you can capture the stories that people who have been trained in your community in mental health first aid and how they have helped those people in their community with emotional health problems, that can be a very powerful and compelling way to advocate for legislation or for funds or for resources in your community. And we're welcome and happy to talk to you after if you have additional questions. But thank you very much. Thank you.